Thank you for joining us as we continue our hypothyroidism. This will be part 4. We're going to talk about differentiation. We're going to talk about, I told you before about the thyroid and the adrenals. They're closely related. How do you differentiate the two of them? How do you know when it's thyroid? How do you know when it's adrenals? There's been a lot of information on this. We're going to go through that. We're going to explain it. We're going to explain why that is. And remember, we're always here to bring the most significant research and news to create your most beautiful, healthy life. And you can visit us at Nutrimost.com, see our reviews at NutrimostReviews.com, or visit us on Facebook. We have our Nutrimost USA page, which is where we live stream. And we also have the Nutrimost Support, which is a member-only. Very easy, just request to be added, and they'll add you to that. That is a closed group, though. You can go to the Facebook Nutrimost USA page every single Saturday from 9 a.m. until 10 a.m., and we broadcast that show. That is a simultaneous broadcast on KDKA, and I am your host. I am Dr. Ray Wisniewski, and we broadcast every Saturday from 9 a.m. till 10 a.m. Eastern Time. That is simultaneous broadcast with KDKA, which is the very first radio station in the world. So it is we're very proud to be a part of that program, be a part of that station. I've been broadcasting on radio for the past 15 years, and I've been doing this I've been in practice for over 35 years now. So actually, I've been saying over 35. It's going to be just in a very short period. It's going to be 35 years. But we're very proud to bring you today some more of the information on the thyroid. And let's just go through some of this. Some of it will be a little bit of a review to get caught up if we need to remind you about some of the things that we went over previously. But let's just go right into this. And typically, in the case of adrenal exhaustion, when we talk about the fact that, and I said this before, that T3 and T4 are going to be maybe low, and the reason is your body tries to down-regulate particularly if it's been under stress for such a long period of time. It says, you know what, let's give this a break. So you can have total T3 and T4 maybe normal. In fact, TSH is either normal or just a little bit high because of the fact that you're not getting that free T3 to the cell. And so adding any type of a thyroid medication without addressing the adrenals is going to be the worst thing that you can really do. And what happens is when the adrenals are exhausted, it's telling the body metabolically you need to slow down. Then the thyroid meds are telling the body to speed up. And what happens is you tend to improve the thyroid blood work. And sometimes you temporarily even have a little bit of improvement of symptoms, but that is very short-lasting. And then over time, the symptoms become much worse, which results in more medications, but still the patient has hypothyroid symptoms. And the doctors come in and they look at this and they say, well, everything's looking good, but it's not good. And the person knows, it's like the doctor says, oh, everything's great, but you don't feel great. And in fact, so often it'll be, if you do the basal body temperatures, you'll have the low temperatures. You'll have heart palpitations. You can have tremors, fatigue, and just all kinds of stuff. And what I call this is, these patients are wired and tired. In other words, they're tired all the time. But then when they go to bed, what happens? They go to bed and they're wired. They can't sleep. And they're like, how can I not sleep when I'm just tired all the time? And it's this whole wired and tired feeling that really creates most of these issues. And so 70% of the patients on thyroid meds actually complain of hypothyroid symptoms. And one of the reasons is that a large portion of these people or actually have adrenal issues. See, there are so many other factors involved, including the adrenals, including the ovaries, including leptin in order to have any of these symptoms, whether adrenal or thyroid. We'll get to that later, but you have to be leptin resistant, really. So when we support the adrenals, so often the thyroid symptoms would just disappear, but the blood work may even still be bad for the thyroid for many months. It just takes a while to catch up, but you have to work with the adrenals. And most doctors are just blinded by their thinking, and they rely so much on the blood work, and their patients just continue to get worse. They continue to be tired and sluggish. So when both the adrenals and the thyroid are weak, and this happens, as I say, far, far, far too often, what happens is that creates a very vicious cycle with the patient just spiraling downward. And what happens is the patient begins getting more tired and sluggish. They keep needing more medications. They are super tired, but they just can't sleep. They're gaining weight, or they can't lose weight. Their basal temperatures are still low. Remember, make sure that you're checking that basal temperature. That is a great indicator, and I believe it's far better indicator than the blood work is. You know, so often we'll do things, and patients will say, "Aren't you going to do any blood work?" And yeah, we can do blood work for different things. We can get a ton of information, but so often, let's take a look at the patient. Let's look at what their symptoms are. And because when this happens, in this particular case, the doctors start increasing the thyroid meds, and they're just baffled because the thyroid doesn't seem to be responding. And now either the TSH is normal and they still feel like this, or despite the high amounts of the thyroid medications, it doesn't correct the TSH. The TSH continues to go high. And so these are all problems. So it's great to understand the thyroid and know how it functions, but you have to know how everything else can be so interrelated. And that's one of the great things about Nutrimost Intelligence. Nutrimost Intelligence helps the practitioner unravel the interconnections, because everything has an effect with everything else. And so when you see things like the basal body temperature going low, and you see it lower than it should, and you know for a fact that, you know, you're looking at the signs, you're looking at the symptoms, you're looking at the patient, you're not looking at the blood work. You know, you're not a number. You are a person. In the old time doctors, they used to just be able to look at a person. They'd look in their eyes, they'd look at their skin color, they'd listen to your symptoms. See, that's what we want to do with Nutrimost Intelligence, and create this with the ability of the computers today. We're able to take that, look and find out, okay, where is the challenge here? And so then we have to say, you know, is it that the thyroid is off because of consequences of some type of imbalance, or is the thyroid primary and causing the other systems to go out of balance? But the whole thing is, you got to remember, there are so many variables. And today, what I want to do is review some of the differences in symptoms between the thyroid and the adrenals. And once you get into that, you're going to see, because we want to differentiate the thyroid versus if it's some other challenge. And by the way, when you talk about metabolism, you know, a lot of people think that metabolism is the thyroid, and not necessarily. In fact, I'm going to go into this much more in detail, because if you really get into it, the liver is the driver of metabolism. All right, and that's a whole other series I got to watch, because it's easy to slide into that. But the thyroid would be more the gas pedal. There's the computer that's running this whole thing. There's keeping track of where this is across the whole board. And that's primarily in the hypothalamus. And that's primarily the information is being communicated through leptin. And so that's one of the reasons why the leptin's job is to control, manage, and direct energy in the body. That's its primary job. And that's why it has such a huge role when it comes down to the thyroid, when it comes down to the adrenals, Even the pancreas with insulin and glucagon has a, those both have major impacts within that. It's all part of that whole neuroendocrine system. And the neuroendocrine system means the hypothalamus, which is part of the brain, which is the neural portion, and it deals with the various hormones of the body. And then when you go down even on a cellular basis, now we got to start to look at the mitochondria, and that which is the powerhouse energy center of the cell. But Roy, I would say that leptin is such a major component to that. So, you know, when we start to talk about this, when you see that a patient's getting, you know, they're on their medication, they're getting, the doctor puts them on, they're getting more and more tired, they're needing more meds because it doesn't seem to be correcting it. They're gaining weight, their basal temperatures are still low. The TSH is either normal and they still have all these hypothyroid symptoms, or that the TSH is staying high and won't come low, even though they just keep giving more and more medications, then you know there is a challenge with that. So what I want to do next is just bring up some of the differentiation between adrenal fatigue and hypothyroidism. And we put it into charts. Different people have gone through this. It's been it's pretty much been shown that there are differences in those symptoms. And let's take a look at some of those. We can see, first of all, temperature. And we're looking at, when I talk about temperature here, when we talk about adrenal fatigue, it's like 97.8 or lower, but it fluctuates and is exaggerated. I would say it's going to be, that is talked about basal body temperature, how I told you to do that, and it will go all over the place, and it usually fluctuates by more than 1 degree. Where hypothyroid is going to be low, it's going to be usually like it, and I have 98.6, it should be in the low 90s to 97.9. That's going to be because that's going to be on the low end. And it's just it's more steady. It sort of stays there each day. Now, depression, adrenal fatigue can give you depression. Hypothyroid is going to be very frequent. Hair loss, adrenals, sometimes it can give you hair loss. And the reason is because it affects copper, which is another area. The hypothyroid is very common. It gives you that thinning hair. And when we take a look at it becomes much more sparse. When you have the adrenal, it's going to be thin and sparse on extremities. With the hypothyroid, it becomes coarse and sparse. With eyebrows, the adrenal doesn't really affect it. They're full. Hypothyroid, one of the easiest things to recognize, very sparse on the outer one third. Nails, adrenals, thin and brittle. Hypothyroid, normal to thick. When you take a look at the tissue surrounding the eyes, I talked about this earlier, with the hypothyroid, you're going to get a puffiness there. With adrenal fatigue, it seems like it just gets sunken in. The skin and skin tone, adrenals, thin and dry. Hypothyroid, normal to oily and moist. Fluid retention, you're going to have that more with hypothyroidism than with the adrenals. Reactions. People become very hyperreactive with adrenal fatigue. And you'll see the jump, phone goes off, a sound, boom, and they just become very hyper. With hypothyroid, they become hyperreactive. With adrenal fatigue, you can get orthostatic hypotension. In other words, you stand up and you get that dizziness. What happens is that it's supposed to squirt some adrenaline, and if you don't get enough of that, your blood pressure will go low. And typically it'll go low by 10 points. So in other words, what you can do to check for orthostatic hypotension, take your blood pressure sitting, stand up, and as soon as you stand, when you get up, you just do the blood pressure again and see if it went low. Does it go low more than 10 points? You most likely have orthostatic hypotension. Blood sugar with adrenal fatigue tends to be hypoglycemic. You tend to have lower blood sugar. With hypothyroid, it's either normal to hyperglycemic. You'll have higher tendency. And by the way, we'll show you why that diabetics tend to become more, have a higher incidence of hypothyroidism. There's a great reason for that. Adrenal fatigue causes heart palpitations. That's frequently you'll have heart palpitations. You don't have that with hypothyroidism. Gastrointestinal tends to be irritable, tends to be hyperactive. It's just the opposite with the hypothyroid. If you have constipation, it's hypoactive. Sleep, with adrenal fatigue, you tend to wake up between at 2 or to 4 o'clock in the morning. With hypothyroid, you tend to just be sleepy, and you don't get great sleep a lot of times, but you're just tired in it, but you will sleep. You don't have that waking up at 2 to 4 a.m., and you become sleepy even and tired during the day as well. Temperatures, adrenal fatigue, intolerance to cold, hypothyroid, intolerance to heat. With adrenal fatigue, you tend to have more cravings for sweet and salty food. With hypothyroid, it's more cravings for fatty foods. So as you can see from that, thyroid dysfunction is more complex than just the thyroid. But when it's between the thyroid and the adrenals, you'll notice there's some things that are just the opposite between them, like the reflexes, hyperreactive with adrenal, hyporeactive with the thyroid. You see the gastrointestinal, it's more hypoactive with the thyroid. You tend to have constipation when you have hypothyroidism, yet it's hyperactive with the adrenals. You'll see puffiness around the eyes with the thyroid. You get the sunken in with the adrenals. So you now understand how thyroid works from part one. Even if it was only the thyroid involved, it's still not that easy. I mean, there are so many processes. When you take a look at from the creation of the T4 to the conversion to T3 to the utilization of the active form of T3 by the cell, in any of these areas, it can be disrupted, it can be interfered with. And so one of those areas that it can be interfered with is from the conversion of T4 to T3. That's the inactive form of the thyroxine to the T3. And so all T4 to T3 conversion does require deiodinase enzymes. And so let's just take a look. There are three types of deiodinase enzymes. Type 1 helps converts T4 to T3, but it doesn't do it as efficiently as D2 does. And it's found in the liver and the kidneys. It is not found in the pituitary. So all physiological and emotional stress downregulates and suppresses D1. All right? And so it's what happens is then you have the deiodinase type 2. And deiodinase type 2 converts T4 to T3 and is 1,000 times more efficient than D1 in this process. D2 also has the opposite response to emotional and physiological stress because D2 is increased or upregulated. This is why TSH is such a poor indicator of thyroid function when you start to thyroid activity when you start to take a look at this, because it depends if it was from the pituitary level or if it's from the liver or at the cellular level. So if serum T3 levels drop 30% due to stress, what's going to happen is D1 decreases, causing the intracellular T3 to decrease over 70%, which is going to cause overt and sometimes really severe hypothyroid symptoms. Yet, as D2 is upregulated, the pituitary T3 is going to remain normal. And so since it's measured at the pituitary, and it's the pituitary that determines the amount of TSH from the pituitary to the thyroid, since it was upregulated, that pituitary D3 is now normal. And so is the TSH. So TSH is normal. So you're producing the same amount of the T4, but here, because of the fact that you have such a, you have the D1 has decreased, that's what causes this intracellular T3 decreases, like I said, over 70%, causing these symptoms of hypothyroidism, yet you have a normal TSH. And that's how that occurs. And then you have deiodinase type 3, which is D3. D3 converts T4 to reverse T3, which is the anti-thyroid hormone and actually blocks T3 receptors. That's why it's called reverse T3. And reverse T3 can create severe hypothyroidism that's really not normally detected. And so giving more T4 will actually make the condition worse because you're going to produce more reverse T3. So you have to take a look at that. And so these are all things that we take into account and your practitioner will take into account. But you have to understand this. So after you have the active T3, and so now the T3 was converted from T4 to T3. And remember, we went through that a little bit more, I think, in one of the other videos. We talked about where it's converted at the T4, which is about 60% in the liver. Then it goes to the intestinal tract and goes through where some is converted to an active form and some to an inactive form. But let's go through this. After the active T3 is produced, T3 has to be accepted into the cell. Now, when you're under stress, that reverse T3 is created at higher levels in the liver. So if the body continues making elevated levels of reverse T3, it's going to damage the cell, basically. Now, the body needs calcium as a balance to respond to T3. So if calcium is present, though, without magnesium or potassium, that's when you get in trouble. And that's why I said you can really make a mess out of things if you just start taking calcium tablets. That's one of the problems with it. And you've seen that there's been research now that shows, hey, you shouldn't really take just calcium. Now, once T3 is in the cell, it needs selenium. One of the best live source ways to get selenium is from Brazil nuts. You don't need very much. Take 1 to 3 Brazil nuts. In fact, you don't want to take a ton of that. Too much selenium causes problems too. Everything should be in balance. So low levels of selenium can actually cause inactivity of T3. By the way, selenium also helps the production of the enzyme that helps convert T4 to T3. And also low progesterone levels can often create hypothyroid symptoms as well. So let's take a look at that. The overview of thyroxine, you know, from that conversion, we said 60% of the T4 is converted to T3 occurs in the liver. By the way, the thyroid itself makes almost all T4. It's at least 93% T4. There's a little bit of T3, up to 7% T3 produced in the thyroid itself. But then it goes to the liver where 60% is converted to T3. 20% gets converted to reverse T3, which is the inactive form, which is typically excreted from the body. The last 20% is converted to T3S and T3AC, which are inactive forms of T3. But the T3S and the T3AC then are converted into the active forms of T3 by bacteria in the if you have a normal microbiome, which again is very, these are bacteria that have an enzyme called intestinal sulfatase. So the gut actually converts about 20% of the T4 to T3. So let's just look at what happens when you're under chronic stress. Okay, so now you have chronic stress. Remember, the D1 is decreased, D3 is increased. These are these deiodinase enzymes. So D3 is what's making the reverse T3, creating the hypothyroid situation at the cell. So at the cellular level, because that's where the D1 is, but D2 is increased. Remember, that's the one that's more active, and it's in the thyroid, and so as it's increased, TSH, it's going to measure that everything is fine, and TSH is going to be lowered. So even though you have hypothyroid in this case, you have normal to low TSH, which means you don't have hypothyroid, yet you do. And the lower TSH is going to produce less T4 from the thyroid. And so the result is this vicious cycle of weight gain, fatigue, and depression. And by the way, we can see this after pregnancy. So a lot of times when somebody is pregnant, after their pregnancy, they can go through this. We also see the same effect with chronic pain. That can do the exact same thing. The other thing is that when people who typically do regular dieting, that's one of the reasons why we do the protocols that we have for a particular reason. It's all about saying, how do we normalize this afterwards? Because regular dieting can reduce T3 levels 25 to 50%. And I tell you what, it can stay there for a really, really long time. So you'll see people who have dieted, lost weight, and then they gain it back again, and then just keep on going. You'll see they'll do that for a long period of time. So first, we know that during pregnancy, there's less Th1 immune response than Th2. And the reason is that a Th1 response is the primarily for direct foreign attack. In other words, a virus. And the conditions that are Th1 dominant, such as multiple sclerosis, they tend to improve or be completely alleviated when you or go into remission during pregnancy. But then right after the baby's born, they tend to have those exacerbations. Where it's the opposite with lupus. I wanted to get into this just because there's things that can affect this. And we talk about in pregnancy that you can sort of, this relays back to, I started to get off when I started to write this because this gets into postpartum depression. And the reason I say that is because of the fact that we know that after birth levels of monoamine oxidase rise, which lowers the monoamines, and those monoamines include dopamine and serotonin, and they lower them dramatically. So that, and those are your happy mood sensors. And one of the best inhibitors of that, and it's also Th1, the same product, is resveratrol. So I'd recommend resveratrol, curcumimus, bimus. You can drink green tea with pregnancy. I just got sidetracked a little bit when I got into this. I'm going to skip through that. But, I talk about this. Let's go to that next thing. Let's take a look at what happens with diabetes. And I started to talk about this earlier when I said, hey, if you're a diabetic, there's a good chance that you can have hypothyroid. And here's why. When you start to take a look at the someone who's not a diabetic versus someone who is diabetic, there's very little difference in the free T4 and the TSH levels. But normal individuals will convert 77% of their T4 to T3, while diabetics convert only about 40%. Okay, so there's only about 45%. And this may be due to the same incorrect message signaling in both diabetes and hypothyroid, because we know that there's a problem with the signaling. And I would propose that a lot of that has to do with leptin. It's even worse with the diabetes. But there's some other signaling that occurs with this. It causes this miscommunication. But you're not converting as much of the T4 to T3. So if you're not converting to the T3, then you're going to have more issues with that. Now, let's look what happens with D1, D2, and TSH when it comes down to these chemicals and organophosphates and heavy metals. First, they'll depress D1 and increase D3, but D2, which is 100 to 1,000 times less sensitive to these substances, and therefore, although T3 in the cell is severely depressed, T3 in the pituitary and thus TSH will most of the time be normal. So that happens again with these chemicals. It happens with organophosphates. It happens with these heavy metals. So again, we see the difference between how D1 and D2 work as far as the deiodinase enzymes and D3 works and how it affects all this. And that's one of the reasons why I say when we take a look at thyroid, in TSH. TSH is not a very accurate way to measure this. I will say this, even though it's not accurate, if it's real high levels of the TSH and it doesn't seem to be affect all these other things and you're having hypothyroid symptoms, there's a pretty good indicator that it's going to be primary hypothyroid and not a secondary hypothyroid, because you can get hypothyroid from so many other causes, from other organs metabolically taking that down, particularly the adrenals. However, if the body is deficient in iodine and we bring in bioavailable live source iodine, we talk about that, that's going to be like our xenomost, thyromost, the TSH can go dramatically, it can go up dramatically, and it can last for up to 6 months to that. So, and this is not hypothyroidism. In fact, one of the things you'll see with that, you bring in this live source iodine, the symptoms completely change. And now here the person is, they feel great, and even though they feel great, their TSH levels are actually higher. And the doctor said, we need to put you on medications. You know, it's gotten worse. No, not necessarily. And the reason that is a sodium iodine symporter. And so when the body is iodine deficient, TSH stimulates the production of the sodium iodine symporter, and the body must have the sodium iodine symporter to drive the iodine into the cells for proper conversion. So when iodine begins to correct it, in thyroid-resistant patients start to improve, the first thing that happens is their TSH can go really high. So it'll actually like spike. And you'll see that after a person becomes more leptin sensitive and they become more leptin thyroid sensitive. And people think, and it's, a lot of times the doctor says, oh my gosh, this is it's gone through, it's terrible. Yet the person feels great, they've lost weight, they're doing wonderful, and they just don't understand this. And it's a doctor who doesn't really understand this well. And the sodium iodine symporter is a carrier system into all the cells. So when that's deficient, those cells become deficient of thyroxine. And that's why basal body temperature is really such a great way to diagnose hypothyroid, because in that case there, where it was a high TSH without the symptoms, and you had a normal basal body temperature, you know that you don't have to worry. So someone goes to their doctor, they're feeling great. They go in, they do blood work done, and the doctor, and you know what, and the doctor will scare the heck out of that person. They say, oh my gosh, they messed you up, this and that, and you went to this natural doctor, and the patient's like, boy, but I feel really good. I feel better than I have in years. And if you don't understand this, if you don't know it, what can happen is then all of a sudden you think that this is a bad thing. But what you want to do in that case, you want to, if indeed that's the case, that you are truly hypothyroid, that means that your basal body temperatures would have dove. I mean, literally would have dove down. And what you'll find out is that's not what's happening. In fact, they're coming up. They may have been down. You had a benign underlying hypothyroid challenge that wasn't being addressed, that was being masked, how we showed you that it can be. So you had symptoms of hypothyroidism, but your blood workup didn't show it. Now we start to get this balance. Now you're able to drive the iodine into the cell and the thyroxine, the active T3 into the cell with the sodium iodine symporter system. You're leptin sensitive now, and the system's working. So it's saying, let's get this normalized. So let's create more thyroxine. Let's drive this into the cell. And you'll see this sudden spike, and people think that was off, when in actuality they felt great. And you have to start looking at how you feel. So many times people will take a look at these, you look at these these blood tests and think, oh my gosh, it's terrible. And that's one of the reasons why this part right here, what we're talking about right now, that's why I'm doing this and giving this information, because that is what is absolutely critical. It's critical. So let's take a look at, so inflammation stops the T4 to T3 conversion in the liver and abruptly turns off your thyroid's ability to function properly despite normal thyroid labs. So we really need to get down inflammation as well. At the same time, your vitamin D production also lowers considerably as well, because number one, tumor necrosis factor takes that out too. But remember, you need the T3 to help convert into these different hormones. Remember, when you don't have proper T3, you don't have proper estrogen levels, you don't have proper testosterone levels, you don't have proper HDL levels, your androgens are lower. You have all these different hormones. So it causes a hormonal disruption across the entire body. Across the entire body. You have immunity fails, and bad things really start to occur for the cell at now the cellular level. So we need to get this self-balanced. So let's start taking a look at this. And this is when we take a look at the thyroid, it is a multifactorial disorder. It's not just low TSH. The thyroid primary dysfunction, that's typically autoimmune. That can be a pretty high TSH. You can have some other immune factors. Blood work can be high with that. Secondary thyroid function, that's incorrect signaling. The drugs always focus on the symptom of the outer range TSH or T3 or T4 instead of really getting to the cause. And so Nutrimost Intelligence is looking at what can we do to support all the clues that the body's giving us so we can help balance not just the thyroid. We want to balance the neuroendocrine system. We want to move towards metabolic homeostasis. And let me just tell you, miscommunication of messages between and within cells is the cause of all chronic disease, period. And one of the hormones that most don't consider much with thyroid issues is absolutely leptin. It's such a big thing. Now remember, when the low T4 and T3 fail to create TSH to rise, this may be caused by alterations in the set point of the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. It's most likely due to the way that D1, D2, and D3 that we went through previously, but it can also be due to a response from the hormone leptin. And the leptin receptor cells in the liver may also cause the increased production of D3 deiodinase when it's leptin resistant. That's why leptin is such a major thing in here, because leptin appears to inhibit the paraventricular nucleus of the hypothalamus, and that's going to decrease the thyroid releasing hormone. And so, which is going from the hypothalamus to the pituitary, then the pituitary does the thyroid stimulating hormone. And so leptin resistance decreases thyroid production without a doubt. Leptin has been termed the obesity hormone or the starvation hormone, but in reality, as I said, it does, its job is to control, direct, and manage energy. And since leptin is produced by the fat cells. In fact, it's produced by the white fat cells, which is the visceral fat. And when there is enough fat, it increases and it tells the brain to stop eating, and now it's time to burn the fat that we have. So we would expect that with obese patients that they don't have enough leptin. But it turns out they have tons of leptin. And the reason is leptin resistance, which means that they're producing leptin, but the brain isn't listening. Okay, and so that's a really big thing. And leptin is very important for diabetics and those suffering thyroid issues. And remember, leptin is produced by the fat cells. Its job is to manage those energy stores. If the body needs more energy and its energy stores are low, it signals you to eat more. and then store some of this energy as fat and slow down the metabolism. So if the body has adequate energy, then it says, okay, it signals the body to, you don't have to eat, you have adequate energy. Just use some of your existing fat stores and let's increase the energy processes, let's increase metabolism. That's basically in a short form how it works. But here's the thing. It also affects so many other parts of the body due to its influence and control of the hypothalamus, of the brain, in its communication signaling. So it's communicating signaling with all these other areas. So it affects the pancreas, affects the adrenals, the thyroid, it affects reproduction. It affects the sympathetic nerve system in the sympathetic response. In fact, leptin may actually be much more influential in diabetes than insulin is, because it really controls that. We find that people become leptin resistant far before they become insulin resistant. And in fact, it's going to be the leptin that's going to determine if you're going to become insulin resistant or if you're going to become thyroid resistant. In fact, if you have proper, you know, we talk about the thyroid, and I said it's not really the metabolic engine. It's the, when we start talking about the metabolic engine, it's really the liver. And it's what happens with excess calories. And as long as somebody is insulin sensitive, you're able to handle those excess calories properly. When you're leptin resistant, now the liver is going to convert that into fat and into visceral fat and causes all kinds of issues. So the main thing that we have to remember is that we want to become, make sure that we maintain leptin sensitivity, okay? And let's just take a look at even inflammation, and the cytokines have a direct effect on the thyroid. In fact, interleukin 6 increases reverse T3 and it decreases free T3. Tumor necrosis factor decreases T3. Infections and microbial metabolites. If you have an intestinal infection, it decreases T3. It increases D3, which is the type 3 deiodinase enzyme, which increases reverse T3. So the inflammatory response is one of the first things that have to be controlled anytime you have a thyroid issue. And so everything that we do with our Nutrimost program is really, it's about balancing the body. It's about getting leptin sensitivity. It's about decreasing inflammation. See, when you're healthy and your body is in energy homeostasis, you really can't have thyroid issues. So when everyone else is dealing with changing a number, and that number being the TSH, we want to get to the cause of the cause of the cause, and we want to just help balance the body. And so when we take a look at Nutrimost Intelligence, what we're doing is we're assessing and correlating the various factors involved in energy and metabolic homeostasis in inflammation. We want to balance and help, and to do that, we want to determine, you know, what are the foods, what are the nutrients that match your body's unique needs and your requirements for energy metabolism. So we get to this metabolic homeostasis. And then, of course, you want to clear and eliminate some of these underlying root causes of these imbalances. And when you do that, that's when you have such a profound difference in your life. So the result is that Nutrimost helps you get the most out of your life really by working smarter, not harder, to help you overcome your challenge. And remember, the cause of almost all chronic disease, including hypothyroidism, including the adrenals, miscommunication of messages between and within cells, which is due to chemical and neurotransmitter disruptors. In other words, we have damaged our metabolism. We damaged the hormones, the neurotransmitters, and the other metabolic factors. We damaged the control mechanism. So when everybody talks about metabolic syndrome, I want you to think damaged metabolic factors. And those factors need to be healed and balanced. And that's what it's about. It's not about just adding a medication. See, Neutromost Intelligence, along with the Neutromost protocols, gives you the rules and the tools to optimize your health potential to help you get the most out of your life. And so, you know, I thank you for joining us. And if you want to, more information, or if you want to have contact us, remember, I am Dr. Ray Wisniewski. You can contact us at any of our locations, actually, throughout the country. We have Nutrimost locations throughout the country. Our number is always 855-NUTRIMOST. We also, that's 855-688-7466. You can visit us online at Nutrimost.com. That's Nutrimost.com. And I really hope that you join us every single Saturday on our live broadcast that we do from 9 a.m. to 10 a.m. That's a simultaneous broadcast with KDKA. It's all about, you know, helping you get the most out of your life. But remember, visit us at Nutrimost.com or see our reviews at NutrimostReviews.com. You can go on Facebook to our live stream at Nutrimost USA or Nutrimost Support. That is a member-only site. But go to Facebook, Nutrimost USA page for our live streaming. We're streaming every Saturday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., and every Thursday from at 12 noon. And it's all about helping you get the most out of Nutrimost. And thank you for joining us. Remember, tune in every Thursday and every Saturday.